So today we are at Piha Beach, which is a really popular destination for people from Auckland, because it's not too far away on the west coast. But today we're going to focus on the geology here, and we are going to be guided by Bruce Hayward, who knows everything there is to know about the geology of Piha and the whole area around here. So Bruce, you're going to show us what these rocks are made of, how they originated, as well as how they have been sculpted by the forces of erosion more recently since they were created.
So I suggest we wander on down there and have a look at Whakaare lion rock first, and let's discuss what we see and let's see if we can figure out what it's doing there.
So we're getting closer to lion rock, and Bruce, what I see is not very clear to me. It looks very chaotic. I see layers going at different angles. I see big blocks, little blocks. Is there something I'm missing? Or
No, absolutely right. When we look at it from here, it looks like a big jumble of rocks all mixed together. And as you say, we can see some layering that's horizontal in the middle of that orange-brown weathered area. But as we go higher up in it, you can see layering that's at a different angle. Let's have a closer look, try and figure out what we might be seeing and how it got there. Here's a couple of nice big boulders that have just come down from up there. And we look at it and we see that all the pieces are quite angular here. We call this a breccia. And when we look at it, all the pieces are of the same composition, which is telling us that it was one lava flow or one injection of lava that's been broken up as it was cooling and solidifying and moving. It's broken up into all these pieces. And so they're more or less in place where they've broken up and been brecciated into these fragments here.
Okay, and what's in between?
So they've got these bright red matrix in between of much finer particles, and the bright red is oxidized iron or iron oxide. All right, so the oxidation only occurs in air, it doesn't occur under the water. So that's telling us that this eruption here was actually into the air and not under the sea like many of the rocks around us. If we come over here just a little bit, we can see all these little creamy white fragments. Those are fragments of andesitic pumice.
Okay.
Now if we go over here, that's amazing.
This looks like one of those lava bombs that you were showing us the other day on Whakaare Mountain.
Absolutely. So that's a spindle or fusiform bomb of andesite.
And
so
I'm delighted to have made such a discovery.
You're magnificent. I first saw this in 1973, this particular bomb. The same one. I've been right. Tracking it ever since, and it's only abraded just a little bit in those 49 years.
Okay.
So you've made a great discovery.
Thanks. If you ever want to make a discovery of Auckland geology, good luck to you. But dream on, because Bruce has probably been there first a long time ago.
So a lot of this is bomb material and spatter that's been erupted into the air. So as it was being erupted, these globs of molten lava were quite plastic, yep. But not completely cool and solid. And as they went through the air, they'd pull out, they might spin, and they develop these spindle shapes. And then they've cooled a bit more, become solid as they're going through the air, and as they've landed, they've retained that shape and been incorporated into this deposit of other material that's been thrown out from the vents. So for your interest, we call this agglomerate.
Agglomerate.
Yes.
That's the everything together.
That's a breccia that's been thrown out from the vent.
Great.
Yeah. Okay, well, why don't we just walk around the corner here? There's something interesting we can have a look at.
Okay.
There's solid lava here, and it's jointed with these cooling joints all through it. So here we see the bottom of this tongue of lava coming in. You can see its contact there with the broken up breccia here underneath it. Well, as we get further back, we can see this as a rounded tongue intruding into the breccia.
So far, we've got breccia, we've got ash, we've got pumice, we've got lava bombs, spindle bombs or whatever
that's
they're
right.
called. And then we've got a chunk of lava intruding into that mixture.
And we've also got red oxidized matrix, which is also telling us about erupting in the air rather than under the sea.
Because some
as
of
are
this,
the bombs.
Yeah. Right, okay. So that's okay, so we've got a volcano. What's the overall story that we're learning about Lion Rock in
well,
that case?
Let's go across the stream and I'll draw you a picture.
Oh, okay. Let's do that. So, Bruce, you've done some artwork here on the beach.
Well, I've started it, Julian.
You started an art piece.
Yes.
Is this related to the topic?
Absolutely. So as I said at the beginning, the hills right around Piha are composed of volcanic conglomerate. So these are the volcanic conglomerates here that surround this whole area, and they're layered.
Okay.
So that's what the most of the country around here is. But we've seen that Lion Rock is quite different. Lion Rock is composed of these brecciated rocks, all of one composition, and bombs and things that have been thrown out of a volcanic vent, it appears. So this is my volcanic vent coming up through the surrounding rock, and it's been erupting. Big bombs and things have gone up here, and they've then, some of them have landed back in here, and we've got this big jumble of material that's landed up here. Some of the ash would have been building up on the sides up here, and some of these sides have then collapsed back down into here. So we've got layered blocks, different angles in here, mixed in with the bombs, the Bretchers, etc. And then we've also seen that lava. So the magma coming up at depth may be intruding into this with tongues coming up like so, of that lava that's coming up and intruding the material that's fallen back into the vent. And then we've had erosion, and in this instance it's eroded right off this, and now we've got Whakaare Lion Rock right here.
Ah, right. Now, if you can interpret that, that chaotic mess, it's very similar to the chaotic mess of Lion Rock. Is that correct?
Yes, it is indeed.
Great. So we're done with Lion Rock. We're going to go to the other part of the beach to see the cliff there, and we'll let you tell us more.
Okay.
We've come a few hundred metres southwards to the end of the beach here, and like you've said, we've got quite different rocks
Absolutely.
To look at.
Well, first of all, let's talk about the introduction to the volcano itself.
Okay.
Okay, so these rocks here are believed to have been deposited under the sea on the submarine slopes of a giant volcano that was located out here to the west.
Okay, so out there to the west right now is just nothing.
That's out in the Tasman Sea.
Okay.
And here's a picture, a map if you like, of the Waitākere Ranges today. Here's the Manukau Harbour coming around here, the Fiji Peninsula. So that's the coast. Auckland is in here. There's the Auckland Isthmus here. So this is Auckland. This is the Waitākere Ranges here. Right? So the Waitākere Ranges are the eroded remnants of the eastern submarine slopes of this giant volcano that we can use remote sensing.
We're doing
like
well.
So. So that was the size of the Waitākere volcano. 60 kilometres across this way, 40 kilometres across that way. And we know by remote sensing techniques that the stump of it, eroded off, is out to sea offshore from where we are here at Piha today.
Okay, so this is all land, that's the Waitākere Range.
Waitākere Ranges.
And that's all out to sea but disappeared.
That's all eroded off.
Okay.
Now this was the New Zealand's largest stratovolcano, and it grew on the floor of the deep sea. If we come over here, here's the floor of the deep sea, and here's the sea surface here. It began erupting here about 22, 23 million years ago. Gradually it would have built up, gradually it built up, and gradually it built up till it was an island, an erupting volcanic island like this. And these conglomerates that we've got here, volcanic conglomerates, are material from the slopes of this volcano, some on land, some under the sea, that have flowed down the slopes and been deposited here as layer upon layer of coarse volcanic conglomerate. So unlike Lion Rock, which was just single composition, if we look in close at these rocks here, we'll see that the cobbles and pebbles are of different compositions, okay, all mixed together.
Okay, and we've got some right here, so can you show
Absolutely.
Us?
Absolutely, let's have a look over here.
What we're looking at?
Now if we look at these clasts, or these cobbles, we can see some are red. So they have been oxidized and erupted on land. So they've come from the volcanic island. Others of these are fresh and grey, light coloured, dark coloured. Some are full of holes like this one. Some are quite smooth. Some are orangey, some are light grey with big crystals in them. They're all different compositions. So these have eroded from different parts of the volcano, all been mixed together as they've been flowing down those submarine slopes and were deposited here.
Great. And just finally, perhaps, there's a lot of this stuff all along this coastline, is that correct?
Yes, most of the Waitākere Ranges is made of this conglomerate, which we call the Piha conglomerate, named for this locality.
Where to next?
Just round the corner.
Okay, let's do that.
Okay, so we can now start looking at the coastal erosion and how it's working on these rocks here. So if we look at the base of the cliff, we get a platform. That's at high tide level, that platform there. And what's happening here is that the rocks above high tide level are eroding back much faster than the ones that covered in the water at each high tide.
Which is interesting, because you'd expect the waves at high tide level to be quite strong and be washing out.
Absolutely. You'd expect the rocks that are being inundated and battered by the waves during the tidal cycle to be eroded more than the ones above the tide, but it's the opposite. And we think the reason is that these rocks at high tide level and below are almost constantly saturated with seawater, so that they're covered with water at high tide and then exposed for maybe 12 hours and they're completely covered again and saturated every 12 hours. So they stay pretty much waterlogged the whole time and are therefore more resistant to erosion than the rocks above, which are getting wet by spray, etc., and then drying out. That wetting and drying will get to break apart and erode much faster. So we can see often right around the coast here, if you look at Lion Rock, there's a lovely high tide platform. It's everywhere around the coast. Another example is this rib of rock that's vertical in the cliff here. Notice how it's wet. That's because of this tiny stream flowing over the top there. And so that little bit of rock in the cliff is constantly wet. It's more resistant to erosion, and so now it's sticking out, and either side is eroding back faster where it's getting wet and dry.
Ah, great. Okay, that's interesting. So that explains to us this ledge going around the coast. And what's next?
If you look higher in the cliff up here, it's not nice and smooth, is it? It hasn't been eroding back evenly. It's cavernous. It's got all these caves scalloped out of the cliff. And we believe that this is a result of what we call salt crystallization weathering, or cavernous weathering, or honeycomb weathering. What's happening there is that we're on the west coast, we get lots of strong winds and salt spray coming up, and it's wetting the cliff. And as it dries, the salt crystals grow on the rock and between the grains in the matrix of the rock. And the growing of those salt crystals pushes the grains apart and starts to break them open. The wind comes along and sweeps those grains away, and it gradually erodes back into the cliff. The more cavernous they become, the more they collect the salt water, and the more exaggerated that cavernous honeycomb weathering becomes. So here's Taitomo Island here, and we can see a wonderful example of how some of the erosion on the coast occurs. We can see a big flat face here of the rock, and underneath you can see it's being cut back with the high tide platform there, and the wetting and drying creating a cut underneath this flat face. The flat face itself was in fact a fracture or joint, a big plane that's parallel to that face there, and the rocks have slid down that joint and to the bottom when they've been undercut.
This looks exciting.
This looks
yes.
Very exciting.
So this is Taitomo Island, and this is what it's named after, this beautiful tomo or tunnel through the island here.
Here we're on a much wilder part of the sea with these huge waves crashing in. Hopefully we won't get drowned.
It's called the Gap. So everybody at Piha knows this is the Gap.
Yeah.
But one interesting aspect of the Gap is that going across the Gap here is a complex of three dikes. These are sheets of lava that intruded up between the conglomerate on either side and force the conglomerate apart. So dikes don't necessarily have to be just a single intrusion. In this instance, there's been three intrusions come up the one fracture over a period of time. So just south of the Gap, we can walk up through the hills and come down through the blowhole here and come through this tunnel that's gone right through the cliff here. And if we look up high in the cliff, we can see, in fact, there's a fracture plane. Let's go and have a look at another cave just a bit further along the beach.
Okay, great.
The sea gets into that soft rock and that fracture and erodes progressively along it until it's eroded right through the cliff. When you look at this particular sea cave, you can see, in fact, it's eroded along two joints or two planes to create this interesting shaped cave. And we've got this lovely tunnel we can go on.
So this is a relatively big cave.
This is a long cave that's gone in along this one major fracture plane, but in several places it branches out, doesn't it? So here we've got a column in the middle. You can go around either side of it in the middle down here.
Exciting.
And the sea would be surging in here at high tide.
Yep, but it's all still quite
but
wet.
Right at the head, it's above high tide in the sand, which we'll see.
Looks like
later on. That you can go that way if you want.
Oh, okay, that sounds exciting. We're going this way around. Oh, there's another pillar. Oh. Bruce, thanks very much for this adventurous bit of geology today.
Oh, I've really enjoyed it, Julian. Thanks for the opportunity to show you around.
So if you are ever here for a holiday, don't forget to have a closer look at the rocks. Thanks, Bruce.